Hi, everyone. We're Science the Show. I'm Alex. I'm a producer and a writer.
I'm Russell. I'm a cognitive scientist, and it's my job on the show to make sure it's about science.
I'm Dylan. I'm a comedian, and it's my job to book comedians for a live show, but for our stream shows, I try to bring a little levity and comedy to the discussions with pop culture references and quips. I'm a honk. I'm a clown.
Dylan's being facetious because, okay, so we started the show about 3 years ago, and when we started, this man could not have cared less about science, and now he's a better science communicator than Russell or I.
It's really nice. It's true. I mean, I met Alex playing Dungeons & Dragons. He saw me do a stand-up show, and it went pretty well, and he asked me to do another show about science, and I said yes, because I didn't have another show booked. And now, 3 years later, I'm helping give a plenary on the importance of science communication, which also, like, 3 months ago, I didn't know what plenary meant. Like, gun to my head, if someone was like, what does plenary mean? I'd be like, did you say planetary? And then, like, boom, I'd be dead. Like, the world's shittiest thing came out of my mouth, and then I died.
Go ahead, sorry, Russ.
Yeah, and you know, like this success, I think, in comparison to what many of y'all in this conference have shown, is you guys have fancy charts and graphs and huge sample sizes, but we have some hard data too, and it's Dylan. And yes, it's a small sample size, but it's big in our hearts.
So yeah, I mean, if we give up SciComm right now, Russell and I, we've succeeded because we've converted one person. And that, you know, if we can get one guy to care, then maybe we can get five or something. So
bar low.
What is it? Low bar is a good bar. You can clear it easy. So what is it that we do, right? We're a science and comedy program. This won't be like your typical plenary. There will be some participation. Hopefully we'll make you laugh and it'll be fun. It's typically an hour and a half, our show, but we're going to have to do something a little bit faster and a little bit different, right? So what we've come to talk about today is the question motivating the whole conference. Is basic research enough, or do you need to have some kind of application or something to make people care? We say emphatically no. We've been producing science and comedy shows for the past 3 years, and in that time, we found that the key ingredient for communicating science to an interested general public, it's not application. It's something else very important.
So for this next section, Russell, can you stop sharing your slides? And we're going to invite, we have some guests. We're going to invite our guests on screen if you want to turn on your cameras. Hello, we got Katie, Daniel, and Allison. Awesome. So what we're going to do is we're going to play a video. And Katie and Daniel are going to react to the video. So, I mean, do you guys know what a reaction video is?
Yes.
Are you familiar with the genre?
Yes.
Okay. Sure. So anyone in the audience that doesn't know what a reaction video is kind of hard to explain beyond its title. You watch someone react to a video. Typically, they don't sit there like a serial killer. They give us some fun, you know, facial expressions. But most importantly, Allison, you are going to watch their faces. Audience, you're going to watch their faces. There's going to be a very distracting, interesting video playing. Don't watch it. Watch their faces. If I say this again, I'm going to explode. I swear to God.
If you don't eat the marshmallow now, you get two marshmallows later.
Very much so. Okay, but yeah, so we can bring up the video, and we're going to watch like a minute of this or so.
I know it's late, but I got so much on my mind.
Get it. Go.
I gotta
go.
Spill it
go.
Out before
go.
The sun
go.
Gets
go.
High.
Yeah.
We're watching the stars get put to bed, just passing time. You and I. But I tell myself, stop, wait a minute. I always catch feelings too fast, but I mean it this time. I think you
yes.
Should stay.
Oh. Awesome.
Where is everybody?
That is how I feel too. I've seen it a bunch of times. I still get really anxious. So yeah, you can stop sharing the video. Perfect. And now, Allison, would you like to describe to us what you saw on their faces?
So they were a little small because little boxes. But at one point, Katie kind of like, you know, did this, and she leaned back, and Daniel was shaking his head. I want to see the video now because I was not watching it. Do I get a chance to watch the video?
We'll give it to you after.
Okay,
after. Yes, after.
So what, Allison, what kinds of sounds did you hear coming from them?
I think at one point Katie said, oh no. I don't know if I heard anything from Daniel, but
I want to say that our friend Spiro writes in the chat that Daniel has seen it all. That's what happens when you're studying off for a living.
That's true. Yeah. Yeah.
So, yeah, I mean, Allison, the things that you're describing and the things that we saw in their face, you know, their eyebrows raising, they're kind of going back, they're making some, the sounds, those things, those are the key ingredient that we think are the key ingredient for basic research communication. So that facial, those facial expressions, those we think are awe. So let's, I guess as of now, so Katie and Daniel, you guys can turn your video off. Thank you guys so much. Allison, we're gonna have you stay on for another minute. So Dr. Dacher Keltner defines awe as the feeling of being in the presence of something vast that transcends your understanding of the world. When we created this show, we did it so that we could pursue this emotion for our own selfish desires, but with the hope that we could pass this on to others. And it's in our experience when doing this that we found that awe is exactly the right kind of emotion that science communicators need to elicit. And we think partially it's because awe has a few things about it that makes it useful for science communicators. So the first one I'm gonna just demonstrate. So Allison, I'm gonna need your help here with this. So initially what I was going to do was I was gonna play some audio clips and ask you to tell me what those audio clips sound like. But Alex and Dylan have instead forced me to do it myself with my mouth.
And we care about so much
you.
Better.
Yeah,
it's
we wanted so to give our funnier. Audience a better show.
So I'm going to turn off my video and I'm going to play some clips and I want you to tell me the corresponding emotion to these clips.
Russell okay? isn't going to play Sorry. Clips. He's going to do a great bit of voice acting for you.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Yes. Okay. All right. So for the first one, huh?
Confusion.
Yes, exactly. Okay. Confusion. All right. For another one, ugh.
Disgust.
Yes. And for the last one, whoa.
Awe or surprise.
Yes. Thank you very much. Thank you, Allison.
Thank you, Allison.
That was awesome. Video. You turned your video now.
This was all to show that that emotions are universal, meaning that when you show them to people, you know exactly what that is, and awe is a part of that. So the evidence that they gather to support this is they will literally go across the world, across cultures and people, and play them these clips and ask them, what do you hear? What do you see? And people indeed say that awe is corresponding to this these sounds. The second thing that we think is really useful is that awe elicits what Dr. Keltner refers to as the need for accommodation, which accommodation is the motivation to question and revise our understanding of the world. It's this need that researchers attribute to a variety of data and findings from studies, such as that those who experience awe also feel like their worldview is challenged, that they're more open to engaging with scientific information, and they think more critically. It's this engagement, this curiosity, and the increased motivation to revise your understanding of the world that, as science communicators, that's exactly what we want from an audience member.
I can't tell you all how many times I've watched a brilliant research scientist feel like they have to couch their amazing research in some potential future business product that could come from it. And I have also watched audiences absolutely not care. For us, basic science, it's literally about the knowledge. And if you feel like you have to use business terms, then the knowledge is the product. And making our audiences laugh, hey, that's our return on investment. Inspiring awe in people is what we call our market share. And having a great good old time with our guests and audience, that's what we call our quarterly EBITDA after adjusting for market inflation and amortizing our losses from fourth quarter purchasing of long-term strategic assets.
All right. Yeah, and that's my 2 week resignation from this show. Just
dude, I love to hate on that, but every time I hear it, I just get it just better and better.
I've heard it so many times. You must.
It's because Russell wrote the joke. He likes it.
That checks out. So, but like Alex was saying, science doesn't need to be a pitch for an inspiring future, right? You don't need to sell someone technology to make them pay attention. Frankly, I exhibit what I would consider an extreme level of techno fear. Is that medically documented? Probably not. Could I have Googled it before now? I shoulda, didn't. But what I'm trying to say is, like, if someone's like, ah, here's a watch that will tell you how fast your heart beats, I'm like, and how does that watch stop my heart? Because I think that's the end game here. It's like, or if someone's like trying to, like, a call to action, get me to do something, I don't like doing things that I didn't plan to do. And maybe it's just because I live a sloth-like life. Fundamentally, what helps me connect to people, and I think what we have found connect to people generally, is like awe is a very human emotion, and it's a lived experience that we all know. And if we all have that same experience, we can all sort of like move together in the same direction, if that makes sense.
Yeah, and you know, I want to emphasize that, you know, all you need is awe. And you know, we've been, and you can get very strong emotions from awe. And so you can get, we've shown, you know, some positive emotions, but there's also the fear of God type of awe. And to demonstrate that,
oh man,
I'm going to share some pictures from a previous show that we did that Alex and Dylan absolutely hate. And so I want Dylan to basically to re-experience this show. And to do that, I'm going to show him some pictures, Dylan, and you're just going to explain, I'm going to walk you through the pictures and you're just going to explain to me what you see.
Yeah, processing trauma by re-experiencing it. Yeah, let's do it, you know?
it works. okay, so for the first photo, Dylan, tell me, what do you see here?
I see some sort of pendulum-like wooden device in a messy room. And yeah, I can't think of anything else to talk about with this horrible thing.
That is indeed a pendulum. What do you see here?
So we've moved in enhance. So we moved in closer. It looks like there's look like guitar knobs. No guitar in sight, which is great. And that's always a good sign. And then there's like some little cube in the center that is clearly stained. It looks red. Is that blood?
So, okay, just as a quick what to expect. So this is pictures from an experiment that we were talking about during this show. And in this experiment, indeed, they used guitar knobs and tuners. And that little red block, well, let's just go on to the next picture.
Hey, it got worse. So now we've added wire to the whole situation. So this is a student film version of the film Hostel, I'm guessing. I know a little bit about anatomy. Definitely. The labels there are parts of human bodies around wire. This is just really a nightmare in real time. And confirmed blood on the right-hand side. You did it. You got me there.
So, okay. Indeed, these are names for different muscles. And those wires will be attached to those muscles. So I'm going to go to the last picture. I'm just going to explain what this experiment is. And for those who are squeamish, like Alex and Dylan, or you just don't like looking at cadaver arms, please close your eyes and look away.
It's such a crazy sentence.
Oh, God. I've created this for myself.
Yeah.
So, okay, what you see here is from an experiment where the researchers here were trying to understand how our hands evolved and asking the question whether our hands have evolved to punch. And the way that they were going to study that is they got a cadaver arm and they were going to have the arm hit a force sensor in different hand positions, so a closed fist or a slap. And they were then using those wires to measure how the forces they travel through the arm to test whether, if it is in a punching position, whether the forces are reduced. So indeed, they did find evidence for this hypothesis. I'm going to go off of this picture, Alex.
Thanks, Sagan. I can't look at that anymore.
They paid taxes. Like, that was an arm that, like, wrote in a W-9, like, the number 4. And now they're on the weird, creepy pendulum with the guitar strings.
This is what they wanted. And, you know, I really love this experiment because it's as basic as science gets. And people feel, as you can see, very strongly about it. And that even though our audience during the show, some of them were a little squeaked out, by and large, our audience loved this show, even though knowing about how our hands evolved to punch will never impact their lives.
No, it doesn't help you at all, right? If you're in a fight, it doesn't matter if you evolved to punch or not, you're going to punch. That's the thing. You don't have to sell people this, like, thing, this product, right? Like, oh, now we're all going to be, I don't know, some punching Superman. They just care because it's interesting and it's fun and it definitely makes you react.
And when I was learning about this work, the other aspect that amazes me is I interviewed the student who led this research.
Oh, and Russ, was their name Frankenstein, perhaps? I don't actually think he got his doctorate. Is that...
Yeah, actually, his name was Frankenstein, but unrelated to my family. No, his name was not Frankenstein. And, you know, but what I was saying was that the endeavor that this student went on to conduct this work was just really incredible. This student had to learn physics to understand how forces were transmitted through the arm. They had to learn anatomy and then basic suturing to be able to do this experiment. And then on top of that, they had to build the entire structure in the first place. And I think about this intense drive to learn all of these things, and it amazes me. And you know, when we talk to scientists, we think this is actually a common thing in when they talk about the work, that they show that they are passionate about the journey of creating the knowledge. And when we relate this story to our audience and showing that this person is so passionate about doing something that is honestly completely random to an outsider, that is just so human that our audience can easily connect with the knowledge and also the scientist who is sharing that knowledge.
Yeah, the way we go about actually like putting together our shows, like live or virtual or otherwise, is we meet with these scientists 2 to 8 times in a month. And in these meetings, we are obviously we want to learn about the research, want to learn like they like long walks on the beach, what have you. But most importantly, like we want to learn where their passion for science and the science that they do, where that comes from. Like, I'm not even kidding. We had scientists tell us that in fourth grade, they saw one of those posters on the wall that said, like, the universe is bigger than you thought. And then they wanted to be like a rocket scientist. And I'm like, that sounds like a lie. But at the end of the day, it's a relatable thing for as a child to feel inspired by something.
Right. And now they're one of like the top dark matter researchers in America.
Yeah, it's nuts. Yeah. It is something like that, something so small and so human that like the idea of being excited and passionate for something that you can connect to and that you can trust that person. If you can trust that person on a very basic level, they can take you wherever they want to go, or maybe at least for me, they can take me wherever they want to go.
I mean, that's right. That's the thing we're really trying to drive home here, right? Is that, okay, I don't know how much of you actually watched our guest faces and how many of you watched the cool video, but the very first thing is a snowboarder jumping off a mountain, right? And we think that what a lot of scientists are doing is just as cool as that snowboarder jumping off the mountain, and in many ways, just as dangerous. But ultimately, right, the reason the snowboarder's jumping off the mountain, yeah, maybe the snowboard technology is going to develop some dope carbon fiber stuff that will like help, I don't know, make your car lighter or make some bulletproof vest or something. But that's not why they're doing it. They're doing it because the trick is rad as hell and everyone can understand that. So that's why we do what we do, to help y'all communicate why you do what you do. We've been signed to the show. We're about to get off stage for you all, but we would love to hear from you. We don't really have a time to take questions, unfortunately. We'd love to collaborate. We're always looking for cool ways to collaborate with people. Find us at any of this stuff here, but honestly, email would be the best way to reach out to us, because at our hearts, we're all boomers.
Oh, to be clear, Dark Mirror of Your Soul is Instagram. Don't we put that in there as a bit, and it's just been there forever. And yeah, you can always send us a fax too, if you can figure out how to do that. But yeah, I think that's us.
All right. Thank you.
Bye.
Bye.